the second half of the summer, we're going to dive into the book of Job and do about a six-week series on that profound and probably very challenging, but also at the same time, good and hopeful book of the Bible. And that will take us through the summer into the fall. And between now and then, for the rest of this month, for the rest of June, we're gonna continue last week. Last week was Pentecost Sunday, and we celebrated the outpouring of the Holy Spirit and the birth of the church. And so for the next 3 weeks, we're gonna look at the sort of middle-ish section of the book of Galatians, which is Paul's letter to this group of Christians that were made up probably of a group of churches in an area called Galatia, which was in the area of modern-day Turkey. This section of Galatians is a place where Paul talks about the Spirit and the role and the work of the Spirit in the lives of believers, in the lives of Christians. And so we're going to begin today. We're going to begin here at the end of chapter 3 and go through the beginning of chapter 4 this morning. And then next week we'll be in the beginning of chapter 5. And then in 2 weeks we'll be at the end of chapter 5. And all this will culminate in that fairly famous passage about the fruit of the Spirit. And I know that one of our small groups this past year has been looking at the fruit of the Spirit, so if for some reason I don't show up on that Sunday, you can grab any number of people to take over. That's a wonderful passage, and that's where we're going to lead, kind of continuing this theme of Pentecost and the Spirit that we began last week. So that's where we are, and that's where we're headed this summer. So before we read the scripture this morning, just a real quick background on Galatians, on this letter. Paul is writing this to these churches because there's some problems, which I find Paul writes a lot of his letters, a lot of our New Testament is because there were churches having problems. That's probably not a good thing, but I also find that to be a very hopeful thing, right? From the beginning, the church has been made up of people, and the church is still made up of people. And it is a good thing to see that we are all kind of in this together. And Paul has some good words for us in that. In this particular letter, Paul is writing about the role of what he often calls the law. The role of the law in the life of Christians, especially in these new Christians who are converting from these Gentile pagan backgrounds, right? The church is becoming not just Jewish Christians, Jewish followers of Jesus, but Gentiles are also coming into the church and following Jesus. And so there's this conflict starts to arrive. What's the role of the law in the lives of these converts, these people coming into the faith? And when Paul's talking about the law in this letter, more often than not, he's not talking about what we might often think of as the moral law, right? This kind of law written on our hearts about what is right and wrong and those sorts of things. What he's talking about is this specific, what we could call the covenantal Jewish religious law. Things like if you're a part of the people of God, the children of Israel, right? Circumcision for males was one of those signs. And so that things like that, that's what he's talking about. What's the role of that? Those markers and identifiers. What's the role of those sorts of things in the life of Christians, especially these converts? That was creating a big conflict in the church and causing all sorts of disagreements and fights. And so that's what he's addressing kind of throughout this letter. And so that's where we are. That's the context. When we jump into chapter 3, we're going to begin with verse 23. If you want to follow along, you can find it in the Pew Bibles on page 189 in the New Testament. So as we go to God's Word this morning, let's pray. Lord, for the gift of your Word for us, we give you thanks. Lord, we thank you that you have been at work throughout history, calling people, claiming people, making for yourself people to reflect your goodness and your promises to the world. Lord, we thank you for your word this morning, this word that offers us both the hope and the challenge of the good news of Jesus Christ. Lord, may it take root in our hearts, growing, challenging, changing us, forming us into the people that you call us to be. Through Jesus Christ. Amen. So Galatians, beginning with chapter 3, beginning with verse 23. Now before faith came, we were imprisoned and guarded under the law until faith would be revealed. Therefore the law was our disciplinarian until Christ came, so that we might be justified by faith. But now that faith has come, we are no longer subject to a disciplinarian. For in Christ Jesus, you are all sons and daughters of God through faith. As many of you who were baptized into Christ have clothed yourselves with Christ. There is no longer Jew or Greek, there is no longer slave or free, there is no longer male or female, for all of you are one in Christ Jesus. And if you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's offspring, heirs according to the promise. My point is this: heirs, as long as they are minors, are no better than slaves, though they are the owners of all the property. But they remain under guardians and trustees until the day set by the Father. So with us, while we were minors, we were enslaved to the elemental spirits of the world. But when the fullness of time had come, God sent his Son, born of a woman, born under the law, in order to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as sons and daughters. And because you are sons and daughters, God has sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. So you are no longer a slave, but a child. For you are no longer a slave, but a son or daughter. And if a son or daughter, then also an heir through God. Friends, this is the word of the Lord. So what Paul is doing in this particular section is he's talking again about the law. And he's basically saying that the law that's being debated and argued about in these churches, and it's the subject of the conflict that's going on. Notice one thing that Paul is not doing is he is not saying that the law is bad, or that it's pointless. In fact, he's saying it's good. It's a good thing, right? Because God gave it for a reason. It was a vital part of God's plan of salvation and redemption. It had a holy, sacred, God-blessed, and God-ordained role to play. Because what it did was, throughout history, it served to proclaim that God had a presence on earth. And God was actively calling and forming and shaping and working through a covenant people, a people he had called together and formed, a people that belonged to God. And so this law was there to guide and shape, kind of mark out these people, so that the promises of the covenant, right? God said, if you remember this covenant, God said to Abraham way back, I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you, so that you will be a blessing, and in you all the families of the earth will be blessed, right? Do you remember that promise way back with Abraham? Right? The law that was given then, after that promise, law was given so that the promise, this promise which is actually universal in scope, this promise would be held out, would have a presence, would be proclaimed and lifted up until its fulfillment. So Paul writes, therefore the law was our disciplinarian. Now the word there, disciplinarian, I think sometimes it has a kind of a negative connotation in our minds, right? As we think of it as a bad thing, as someone who's maybe this ruthless taskmaster. But some translations here say, so the law was put in charge to lead us. And that's because this word disciplinarian here, it was a word that was used to describe the person who was responsible for getting the kids from their parents to their tutors or their teachers. It was the person that got them, the person that was responsible in their parents' stead, the person responsible for getting them where they needed to go, where they needed to be. So we might think of this as saying, therefore the law was our bus driver, our school crossing guard, until Christ came, right? Leading us to Christ so that we might be justified by faith. But now, Paul writes, but now that faith has come, we are no longer subject to this supervision, to this guide, to this bus driver, to this crossing guard. Why? For in Christ Jesus, you are all sons and daughters of God through faith. And then a few verses down from that, and if you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's offspring, heirs according to the promise. Right? Because the law itself, the rights of the covenant, they were actually never what made you children of Abraham in the first place. They were there for a reason. They were good and holy, but what they were marks of the fact that you were children of Abraham. They were signs of it. And so in that way, they guided and directed you into living out that promise and into living that promise out. But even then, right, it's all founded on what God did, not the fact that you were following these things. That's not what made you a child of Abraham. What made you a child of Abraham was what God had done and what God was doing. And so now Paul's pointing out that the fulfillment of all those signs and promises, it has come. The thing that was guiding and leading you toward the promise that they were calling you to live into and to live out, God's presence in the world, and the blessing and salvation and redemption that comes with that. Now Paul is saying that has reached its fulfillment. It has been fulfilled in Jesus Christ. It is through him that you are truly heirs to the promise of God. You are heirs to the promise. Not because of the things that you did. Not because you even followed all those good, God-ordained religious things, right? One of the main points of this entire letter to the Galatians is Paul saying, don't confuse that. Don't confuse those two things. Don't ever, ever get seduced into thinking that salvation and redemption requires Jesus and fill in the blank. Because even these very good things of the law, they were only signs that were guiding you, signs guiding others and pointing others to what was true about God. You are heirs because of what God has done. And it's always been that way, Paul is saying. God was the one who called and initiated the covenant with Abraham and blessed him and made him to a great nation. God was the one sending the prophets, constantly calling his people back into the life of the promise. And God was the one who, in the fullness of time, sent himself, came in the flesh to fulfill his promise. Excuse me. And so now, as we move through what Paul is writing here in Galatians and how he is viewing the law, he talks about how even for the people of God awaiting the Messiah, you can be a son or a daughter. You were sons and daughters. You are sons and daughters, and therefore an heir. But even then, because the fullness of time hadn't yet come, you're an heir, but you're still a child. You're not ready. It's not time yet. So you're still under the guardians and guides and all of that. You still, even as an heir, you still need a crossing guard. And that's where he is when we get to this next section of our passage here at the beginning of chapter 4. Where he says, my point is this. Heirs, as long as they are children, are no better than slaves, though they are the owners of all the property. But they remain under guardians and trustees until the date set by the Father. So with us, while we were children, we were enslaved to the elemental spirits of the world. Right? Paul is saying, you are heirs. Even those brought up in the covenant, Paul says, and Paul was one of them, we were also children. The time wasn't right, and so we were still in need of this guide. He's drawing on an analogy that in that culture, as a child, even as an heir, as a child, your status for that time, your standing in society was on par with the servants and slaves. Right? Your life is not your own. You are under the guidance of others. Right? You are under the guidance even of your family servants. That was your role until the time became right. And those elemental spirits that Paul is talking about, sometimes we think of those as kind of a euphemism, right? I've heard him talked about as, well, he's talking about some sort of demonic spirits at work in the world or things like that. That's not what this word is. That's not what he's talking about. This isn't a euphemism for any sort of mystical or spiritual forces or anything like that. This is really what he's talking about the ABCs of life. That's what that word, that phrase means. Right? So he's saying the elementary, very basics of life that God is calling you into. That was where you were. The ABCs. Even, Paul is saying, even us Jews who are and have been God's people and will be God's people, and therefore, yes, we are heirs, but at that time, also children. And so the law was there guiding and leading us and leading you to this point, and it is fulfilled in Jesus Christ. What he's talking about, it's like a beginner music student.
There's Derek.
You teach music, right?
I do teach music.
Yeah. So what he's talking about is like playing the scales, the ABCs. That's what you start with, right? You have students, they start.
Yep.
They can do it over and over and over again, right?
Yes.
Why?
It gets the dexterity of their fingers moving. It gets them to learn the steps of the keyboard. It gets their fingers understand music theory.
Yeah.
Then from there, you learn chords and melody, you understand. It's like building blocks.
Yeah. Yeah, the goal is not to have these proficient people out there in concert halls playing scales.
No.
Right? That's not the goal. As beautiful as those scales may or may not be, right? The scales are not the goal, right? Because they are the ABCs, they are the building blocks that you need. They are the elemental basics that will lead you, right? They lead and guide you. And in fact, what the scales do is they hold out a promise to you. A promise of a more fulfilled music career, right? When the time is right, these scales, they are the blocks that allow you to build on them, and they guide and lead you, hopefully, into a fulfilled life of playing and creating these expressions of deeper and more moving and more profound beauty. That's what the elemental, that's what the ABCs are there for. Paul's saying that was the purpose. That's the purpose of the law. But now in Jesus, the time is right. And everything that they were pointing to, everything that it was, they were guiding and leading God's people to, that time of the ABCs has been fulfilled. And now it is time to play something, to play into something far more beautiful, something that was always the goal. And that is a life lived as full sons and daughters, as heirs to God's promises. When the fullness of time had come, Paul writes, God sent his son, born of a woman, born under the law, in order to redeem those who were under the law. Right? He's saying God sent his son to step into these elemental ABCs of life, so that we might receive adoption as sons and daughters. He goes on and says, and because you are sons and daughters, God has sent the Spirit of His Son into our hearts. Right? Because the Son of God has come, because Jesus has lived, because the Word became flesh and lived under the same law, because He died and rose again, victorious over all that would keep us from our true family, our true parent. Because He ascended back into heaven, He ascended so that He could send the Holy Spirit. Because you are sons and daughters, God has sent the Spirit of His Son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. Right? See, you were worried we weren't getting to the Holy Spirit, even though I said we were going to be talking about it. Here we are. Because the Spirit has come. Not just to work or speak through a select few as the way God worked in the past, but because of Jesus, the Spirit is now given to everyone who believes in Him. the Spirit that we talked about last week at Pentecost, the Spirit poured out into the church, right? The big C, capital C, universal church. And the Spirit has likewise been poured into the hearts of each and every individual believer. If you trust in Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit lives and resides in you. And this is the Spirit, Paul writes, that cries out, Abba. Spirit lives in us. And so we are able to cry out because of the Spirit that now lives in us. We cry out, Abba, Father. I have a former pastor of ours back in the other land of Virginia. His family, his kids, when they were growing up, they were avid swimmers. They swam year-round. And they were members of the local JCC, the Jewish Community Center. They had a year-round swimming program. So they spent a lot of time there. They're swimming. And he talked once about this time. It was a Saturday or something. Kids were there doing lessons or swim team practice or something. They're swimming. There are all these little kids running around. And suddenly he starts to hear from all over the place. He starts to hear cries of, Abba, 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 Abba. And he said, you know, as his first thought was, what's going on? People are praying. That's a church word. And what he realized is it was simply these little kids running to show their daddy something. A new dive or stroke they had learned, or running because they needed a towel. It was just kids running to their dads, calling out, Abba, Abba. Right? This is now an intimate, familial relationship that Paul is talking about. Deeper than servant, deeper than coworker, deeper even than friend. Abba, the language of a child calling out to their daddy. Language that says when those kids were doing that, they were not just saying who their dad was, they were saying something about themselves. They were saying, who I am is defined on this other person. My dad, my parent, my mom. Because it's not about who we are. It's not about who you or I am in and of ourselves. It's about who we are. It's about who you are and who I am in relationship with God. A deep, familial, personal, intimate relationship. That is what fundamentally defines you. That is who you are. Even on those days when you're not sure if you believe it. Or even on those days when it certainly doesn't feel like it. Is still who you are. Because the Son of God has come. Because he came, the Holy Spirit, what Paul calls here the Spirit of the Son, has come to live in us, to live in you. And if the Spirit of the Son lives in you, well then you too are a son or a daughter. So, Paul writes, you are no longer a slave, or even a child who still has to live like one, or live like a servant, but you are a son or daughter. And if a son or daughter, then also an heir through God. So as we close up looking at this passage, that will lead us into a deeper look in the next couple weeks of how this plays out. When we think of heirs, we often think of it in future terms, right? And there certainly is a future element going on here. We live in kind of the already, not yet, of the promise and the inheritance. By the way, the inheritance, this talk of heirs and inheritance, it's not about just stuff that we get in the future. What we get is God. That's the inheritance. It's the promise of being in the good, fulfilled relationship with God and his people. His creation, the heavens and the earth. This inheritance is the promise of being in the full shalom and peace of God. That's the inheritance and the promise that we are heirs to in Jesus. But the calling and the promise of this, the promise of which we are heirs, is not just about the future. It's also for here and now. Right now. Because what do heirs do? They live like heirs. right? Our culture is growing. We have kind of a whole subculture of people. I'm not going to name names, but you know who they are, right? They are famous. And they live their lives the way they do. They are famous and known for absolutely no other reason than that they are heirs to family fortunes. Right? That's what defines them. That's what defines their life. And so if people like Paris Hilton, okay, I'm going to say one. If people like Paris Hilton can teach us anything, right? I don't even know if she's still around doing things, but if she can teach us anything, it might be the only time I'm going to say that phrase. If she can teach us anything about the Christian life, it's that those future promises are a part of who you are right now. So live like an heir. That's why the Spirit has come to live in you and to cry out, Abba, Father, so that you can truly live like someone whose life is defined by who their parent is. Live like an heir. Not an heir to all the stuff that won't and quite frankly can't last. Like, let's be honest, so many of us do. Live like an heir to the promise that cannot fail. As heirs to the promise we have in Jesus Christ. As heirs, as sons and daughters of the Lord. The one who is the true King, and who is also your Abba in Jesus Christ. As we continue on in the next 2 weeks, we'll flesh this out more. This idea of the Spirit that has come to live in us, and therefore we are called to live like heirs, and we'll flesh out a little bit of what that actually looks like. Right? More what it challenges us with, and what it points us to, and where it brings us hope. But for this morning, know this. Because of Jesus, His Spirit is alive and at work in you. The same Spirit that's been at work since creation. The same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead is alive and at work in you. And the Spirit enables us. Actually, that's not the right word. The Spirit makes us, informs us, and changes our fundamental identity into that of heirs, into sons and daughters. The Spirit has come. Live in your hearts. Change who you are to make you sons and daughters. So family, live like an heir. Live in the confidence and the assurance that comes from being the son or daughter that you are, that you have been made to be in Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Lord, for this promise and for the work that you have done in Jesus Christ and for the gift of the Spirit that you have poured out, not just around us and among us, but in us. Lord, we give you thanks. Lord, we pray that you would speak to our hearts, remind us again and again who we truly are in Jesus, your sons and daughters. Lord, remind us and show us the hope and the good news that is. Also the challenge and the calling that is. Lord, speak to us and speak through us, through your Spirit. It's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen.